Yeah, then I will.
We are in the adult class at Shepherd and Hill Presbyterian Church in Chaska, and it's our delight to welcome to this group. We're always looking for younger people here, and so two young ladies.
You forgot that wrong.
Whose youth includes, whose memories include what fewer hours mainly in the period of the Great Depression. And so Maxine Hathaway moved here to Chaska
in
2006 with her husband Bill, and was to be closer to her daughter and son-in-law and grandchildren here. Carol Dauwalter is a charter member of this church. And previous to that, I think, Carol, right, a member of the First Presbyterian Church of Carver. And her husband's name was Earl. And they were central to the formation of the founding of this congregation in Chaska. Carol has been here ever since as a faithful member of this congregation, one of the quiet people of this church, with a twinkle in her eye and a wonderful sense of humor. So we're here to, we're at your feet this morning to hear from you about the Great Depression. And we're recording it because we want to maintain it, to keep it for posterity.
Carol. My voice is a little scratchy because of my stupid cold. Anyway, mine is kind of sort of like a story, and I decided to do it just so my kids would know what it was like for me growing up, because after I got older, there's so many things that I wished I had asked my parents. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're a kid, you don't much care what they did when they were young. But then as you get older, you think, oh, why didn't I ask them about that? Mm-hmm. And so mine is kind of like a story. And from the time that I remember, and it was about 4 years old. So after I retired, I got off my old word processor that died a slow death on me. So I got a little boobies here and there. Anyhow, I decided to do that. So it's kind of a fast book. But anyhow,
we have plenty of time.
I don't remember the exact dates of the Depression, but it was somewhere in the 1930s and continued for a few years. In the book Grapes of Wrath by John Steinbeck, he writes about the dust storms in Oklahoma and other states and the poverty of the people living there. Minnesota had its share of dust storms and drought too, but we were not as bad off as Oklahoma. I was still in grade school and was junior, probably 7th or 8th grade. One of the girls in school had a piece of pie crust and a dill pickle every day in her lunch. I can only assume her parents had flour and lard and had made pickles. I wondered why she didn't have bread instead of pie crust. But as I think back, they more than likely didn't have the money to buy yeast. Our mother baked bread 3 times a week, so we always had a sandwich in our lunch pail with either jam or sorghum. Since we lived on a farm, there was always enough milk for us to drink, even though the cream was taken off the top because it all went through the separator, a device that separated the cream from the milk. Mom would save some of the cream to be used in coffee or other needs. The rest would be sold to the creamery in Carver and was used for making butter. That was part of the family's income. The potato crop was stored in the cellar, as well as onions and carrots and rutabagas and apples, which you hoped would last through the winter. So living on a farm had its advantages. I remember my mother saying that 1 month the cream check was only $10. However, did they manage to get through the long cold winter. In the fall, my sister Sylvia and I walked to and from to Carver High School, and I can remember how our skin and clothes would be full of dirt and dust from all the topsoil blowing off the fields. For a couple of summers, Minnesota and most of the Midwest went through drought with hot temperatures, and the folks looking at the sky for some rain clouds that weren't there. One time it did cloud up and look like a light rain. I could just see how anxious my mother was, so I went upstairs to my bedroom and got on my knees and prayed for rain. I thought God would surely hear me if I got on my knees. And it did rain a few drops, but surely didn't help the problem. Years we did have some bad storms and tornadoes, and I would sit on the cellar steps scared to death the house would go over. One time the doghouse flew over with the dog in it. Think how scared that poor dog must have been. Sometimes the outhouse would blow over, but that was easily put back on its proper place. If it was thundering and lightning when we were walking home from school, we would put our tin lunch pails under our foot. We felt protected, but the folks laughed at us and told us that wouldn't happen. The older boys would sometimes find work as a hired man. But Emery, my brother, and incidentally Emery is the one that made the cross and the baptismal font and the candle things for us, always stayed home and helped on the farm. All the boys spoke as nearly everyone did in Orchard, and they would roll their own cigarettes and thin pieces of paper and tobacco. There was a time when I found a dime on the floor. I knew it wasn't mine and should have looked for its rightful owner. The selfish little girl, I dreamed of what I could get for that dime. The owner was Emery, and it was his last dime that would buy him a pouch of tobacco, and he was hunting for it. But my conscience was really bothering me, so I pretended to look for it, exclaiming, "I found it!" And he was so grateful. Somehow we all grew up, and life was a struggle for some of my siblings, and all have had problems of some kind. But most of us have coped, and life is full of blessings. Thank you, God.
That's one of the things.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, my story is similar. I grew up in a small town on a farm, and the very small town surrounded by all these farms in Illinois, about 100 and some miles south of Chicago. All my growing up and through my teenage years, it was all in the Depression time. In 29, the stock market crashed. I was 6 years old, so hurry up and figure out. And I didn't know anything about stocks or what was going to happen. And but eventually the banks started to close, and we had one bank in our town, and I don't know how much money my parents had or if they lost money. It was something that we just didn't talk about.
But I was, you know, young, and the only thing that I thought about, I was hearing that people were jumping out of the windows in New York, and there was a lot of people that committed suicide. But life went on, and I always had plenty of food, and in the summertime, we canned, and the cellar was full of canned all the vegetables, and then we had fruit. And in the fall, it was butchering time, and we had a smokehouse. And I loved going in that smokehouse because there'd be big hams hanging and slabs of bacon. And incidentally, that was the only place I knew that was ever locked up. So life was going on, but there were many, many people who could not afford to feed their families. So children were sent to live with relatives. The orphan homes were full, and some children were just left. Some families just packed up what they had and took off. I don't know where they were going, but to relatives or someplace, maybe they thought they could find a job. Our house, our home that we had was right off the highway and close to town, and this was a familiar sight of the people packing up and moving on. And like today, unfortunately, there were people that didn't have money, and they helped out those who didn't. But there were also people who were skimming it off the top, so we say. And there was apparently an ad put up someplace. If you gave so much money to this person, I forget the town, but it was out west, and I'll say Oklahoma or something like that. You send him the money, and there would be a job waiting for you when you got there. So some people did, and when they got there, it was not but a bare field, which was, so we have a lot of that today. But anyway, getting back, being close to town, we often had people, usually men, at the back door. Mother would see them coming up the lane, and she'd say, oh, here's somebody that's hungry. They came to the back door. They asked for work and then something to eat. And they were always polite. If it was evening time, they would ask my dad if they could sleep in the barn. And he would say, yes, if you don't smoke. And to my knowledge, we never had any trouble. And entertainment, we made our own. We played outside, and as long as we could, and we played ball and tag and hide and go seek and you name it, all those weird games like my grandkids say. And in the winter time, we played around the dining room table. We didn't go very much. You know, the big thing was to go to town on Saturday night, and then you would see, you know, some friends. And we always on Saturday, my dad would take 5 gallons of cream to the creamery to sell. And then he would sell a load of oats or corn. I know that at one time, corn was selling for 10 cents a bushel, so you didn't get very much. But then, that money, at as years went on, that was the only extra money that we had that I knew of. So we only bought what was absolutely necessary, and or you went about. My clothes were made over from my sister's that she had outgrown. Any scrap of material was saved to make a quilt or a braided rug. And I had two dresses 1 year for school. I remember those. And I had a blue jumper and blouse that Sunday school. We always went to Sunday school with our penny wrapped up in the corner of the handkerchief. How much money did you have in your handkerchief?
Penny?
Oh, you had a penny.
Well, okay. You better not lose it.
And that.
Or Carol would find it. Yeah.
I've been given that ever since.
We did go. The World's Fair was in 33, and it was going to close the last few days. It was in Chicago. Thank you. It was in Chicago, so my dad made arrangements that we would go one day to the fair. We didn't drive our car, but some people were making a little money driving to the fair. So we went real early one morning and spent the day at the fair and came home. I didn't go back to Chicago until I was in seventh or eighth grade. So I didn't go very much, but I didn't miss out on anything. It was a good time. And
Maxine, do you remember the year of that World's Fair?
33?
Yes.
33. Well, high school was fun. And one thing about going to school at that period, there was no competition in clothes. Definitely no designer clothes. But the most exciting thing was Sears and Roebuck and the Abercrombie reward. But we had fun. The entertainment was going to the basketball, and sometime we would have a school dance by, just a record. And there was one movie in town, and I didn't go to any movies, but if you had a date and if the kids had a car that they could borrow, sometimes farm kids had a car, but no, town kids didn't have a car. So if you went to a movie, if you had a date, went to a movie, you had a big, that was something. And there was a roller rink, I remember. But I wasn't allowed to go there. The kids were wild. Well, like any kids, I did go. My folks did go.
Carol was at the roller rink.
Yeah, I took a meter there.
I was sitting on the farm.
But anyway, we didn't skate, but the kids didn't look wild to me. I don't know what wild was then, but they didn't look wild to me. Probably somebody had some beer at one time. But anyway, that was it. Well, let's see. Hoover was president. And in 33, FDR was elected president. And he was practically the only president I knew for all those, but he had 3 terms. And when he became president, things began just a little bit to pick up. He had these wonderful programs, CCC and WPA. And we can thank those 2 programs for our beautiful parks today. The steel mill in Indiana picked up, I remember. And then, of course, in 41, the war broke out. And all the factories went for work, you know, and people got back to work, and but you things were still kind of tight. But that was just how I lived through the Depression with my folks. We all ended up in Chicago. I had two older sisters and two older brothers, and they were all in Chicago working. And then after high school, I went to work in Chicago, and my folks came. And that was my story of depression and wonderful stories. I do have one more thing. I've been chatting a lot. That's me. And this morning is Carol and I were waiting for our chauffeur. There was a gentleman sitting waiting to go to church, and he saw this book. And he lived in the Badlands. And, of course, he had stories. And he was telling that on Saturdays in town, out in front of the stores, they would have these big tables, I guess, of all kind of food. And people would come with their... He said something about spraying the food. Did you hear that? Well, anyway, they would come and fill their baskets full of food or sacks. Now, if we could go to this grocery store today and buy, we could get sweet potatoes 9 pounds for a quarter. We could get fresh pike 10 cents a pound. Potatoes a peck 21 cents. Pears a bushel $1.29. Cheese 17 cents and onions 10 pounds for 19 cents. And then, if you went to the restaurant, you had a choice of fried chicken, hot catfish, breaded veal steak, can you imagine? Baked fresh ham or roast beef. Then you could have potatoes, something else. Fresh peas, buttered okra, stuffed eggs, vegetables or sliced tomato, salad, ice cream or caramel cream pie, hot rolls. Guess how much that costs?
$25.
You didn't get all of that. I didn't expect you to have a choice, you know, of so much. But still, 25 cents.
25 cents was minimum wage the first year I worked.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Well, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. And when I was growing up, my dad popped up and a hired hand maybe got a dollar a day.
What was the town, the nearest town to you growing up?
Paxton. Or, well, we were north of Champaign.
Uh-huh.
North of Champaign. And here's the dinner. Well, this little boy and his burlap clothes. And does anybody else have good stories?
I remember my mother said when she graduated from high school in 1936. She graduated from high school and she got a really good job as a secretary. And she was making, does that sound right, $16 a week?
For what?
A secretary. 1936, she graduated from high school and was hired as a secretary and made $16 a week. And her father made her quit because she was making more than her father.
Oh.
That was unacceptable. But I was wondering, what were your, on the farm, being that you were girls and all, what were your chores? Were your chores all in the house? Did you do anything with the farm or the animals or the planting? Or were you, I assume, being farm kids, you had lots of chores.
Yeah. Oh, we had.
Well, I had all these six brothers, so I didn't really have to do any outside work. But we helped our mom with dishes and cleaning and that kind of stuff when you were old enough.
Mm-hmm. Did you bake bread or did you store-bought?
My mother baked three times a week. We were 10 kids in my family, so I was a lot of bread.
So did she teach you to bake? And
well, I called her one time and asked her about a recipe, you know, because I was going to make bread, and I said, well, how much flour should I put in there? And she said, well, when it feels right.
Yeah.
How is it supposed to feel?
Great. It's just sticking to your hand.
I want you to a recipe book. We had this old wooden cook stove that burned wood, mm-hmm. and when she was going to bake something, she put her hand in the oven to see if it felt the right temperature. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But she baked wonderful bread, and she never burned anything or undone. Or
it sounds as though the farmers were the best off during that period of time.
Yeah.
Just because you were able to produce your own food.
And they didn't waste one thing.
Yeah. Now.
And they saved everything.
Did you, and maybe you don't know, but did your folks have a mortgage on the property at all?
Well, I don't think so.
Because, yeah, I've heard stories of the banks demanding.
Well, we paid $800 for it in the first place.
Oh, okay.
For the farm, you know.
Okay.
Did your parents inherit that farm?
No.
Did yours?
Yeah. Actually, they lived in Minneapolis when they got married, and they were there about 2 years, and then they went off to the farm.
Barb has her hand.
I was 4 years old in 1933, and I remember a poem from the election campaign, I guess. It was, Hoover, Hoover, he's no good. Chop them up for kindling wood.
We think they're talking now.
Wow.
I had, little jobs to do. One was to gather the eggs,
gather the eggs.
And get the cows from the pasture. Of course, they just knew when to come, so that wasn't anything. And no, we didn't get an allowance. In fact, we didn't even know the word allowance, But would you believe that when I was a little kid, I drove the tractor.
Uh-huh.
I mean, big tractors. Uh-huh. And my mother also baked. And I took my lunch to school, and I had homemade bread. We also made our own butter, and always some kind of meat or something like that in. But yet, the kid that had the store-bought bread and the piece of bologna, I thought, gee, that looks good. So we always like something.
Gosh.
You know.
Yeah.
If we don't have.
So what color were the eggs?
Oh, white.
White?
Yeah.
Really? Huh.
This may sound stupid, but I don't know. Do hens lay eggs every day?
Mm-hmm.
Well,
every day.
Every day
in the winter.
And they slow down?
Yeah. Were you allowed to play with the Catholic children?
Oh, haven't you hardly
there weren't any around. They were all
saved
where I live.
Yes, we had a Catholic family, neighbors, and we were good friends of theirs. But, you kind of stayed on your side of the street when you went down. All little towns have lots of churches, I remember. Did you have lots of churches?
In the country, also.
Yeah, but you went town sometimes.
Well, not often.
You grew up in East Union.
I did.
Oh, still nothing there.
You said you went to Carver High School?
The Carver House. I went there for 2 years.
When was it?
It was 3.5 miles from our farm, and my sister and I walked to and from, just 7 miles a day. We were walking before it became the healthy thing.
Seven miles a day.
Probably why I lived so long.
That's right. Uphill both ways?
Yeah.
No matter what the weather was?
Well, they never closed schools in those days. And you know, you girls wore dresses, and we had the rayon stockings, and my mother made our coats, so you know, they weren't that warm. Mm. Yeah, it was mighty cold.
You forgot about the long underwear.
Well, that was grade school. In high school, you wouldn't wear long underwear.
Oh, God.
Carol, there was, I think it's maybe still there, a brick building in downtown Carver that was used as a school. Is that the high school you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought so.
Then it closed.
Yeah.
At Harvey's?
So I went for 2 years in Carver, and then the other two I went to Chaska.
What did you take for classes in high school?
Our classes?
Yeah.
We had general science and algebra, which I hated with passion, because I didn't know how figure out X plus Y or something. Science of some kind in English. And we did a lot of memorizing and of all those great poets like Longfellow and Whitman. So that's about what you took.
Okay.
And then when I got to Chaska, then I took shorthand and typing.
Okay. Remember when your options were taking algebra or business math in high school? Mm-hmm. That's when I graduated from high school. Which I think makes a lot more sense because...
Well, what did you do for, let's say, it's Sunday afternoon and Sunday evening. What was Sunday like for each
of
you?
Well, we always went to church. My mother always made something special because it was Sunday. And she'd always have some cake or something baked in case somebody came to visit because, you know, then people just popped in. And she probably popcorn. My parents never did any outside work on Sunday. You know, they didn't work in the garden, or all they had to do was the milking and feed the chickens and stuff. So it was kind of a day of rest for them, which is a good thing.
And
my mother would sometimes popcorn, and we'd just sit around and visit, or I don't know.
So listen to the radio at night?
We did have one for a little bit, but that was we didn't have electricity or water in the house, so only if we did have a radio, it was battery operated.
So where did you get your water? Did you have a pump in the house or outside?
We had a pump just a little ways from the back door.
Would it freeze up in the winter?
Sometimes.
Hmm.
And then, of course, you had to haul all that out. You know, you dump it in the slop pail and haul it out.
So and then the coalescent then went to water the flower beds.
Yeah.
So you did candles in the night and fire?
Well, we had kerosene lamps.
When did you first see a television set?
After we were, I'll have you know that we were the third people in Carver to have a television.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, my husband was in the war, and I think they got a $200 refund for whatever reason. So, and televisions were just coming in, so that was our purchase for a 12-inch Zenith.
Do you remember how much it was?
I suppose it was $200.
Do you really think it was that expensive? I imagine it would be very expensive.
It was because they were in low.
Oh, my goodness.
And black and white.
Yes.
My television was only 9 inches. Mom, you were the first television.
How many siblings
we had a radio.
Did you have?
And
I
we
had six brothers and three sisters.
Oh,
Amos and Andy and Little Orphan Annie.
Never
want
for company.
All of
no,
great.
We had a
Carol McGee.
And my sister and I are the only ones left.
Uh-huh. He likes that.
And Jack Armstrong.
my Bill's sister who was older than Bill, she worked at the guy store for 10 cents an hour. $8 a day.
Max, did you have a question?
About medical care, were you born at home and your brothers and sisters on the kitchen table or in the bed?
No, I think we were born in the bed, but I don't think we were born on the table.
You don't remember back that far?
Your brothers and sisters, do you recall their births?
My younger brother I remember, and he's 6 years younger than I am. So I'm at the bottom of the family.
Maxine?
Well, I have a different story. I was the first cesarean born in this hospital.
Wow. Oh, my.
And the doctor, oh, I think my brother's sisters were born at home. But the doctor wanted to charge $1,000. But the family doctor said that's too much money. Well, I don't know how much it costs, but $1,000.
Wow, that's a big
amount. You're an expensive baby.
Yeah, Bill and I were.
Did you have midwives at home, or did the local physician come out?
Yes.
Pardon?
Mothers just brought the children home, and everybody took care of them. If you were sick, when you... You didn't go to a doctor, you know, if you had a bad cold or anything. Mm-hmm. Mom would just put lots of thick salve on your chest, and you had to stay warm. And if you had a sore throat, you had sticks around your throat. And the right throat.
The wool sock.
Did you stay home from school, or did you
stay home? No, yeah. Stayed home.
Stay home.
But I don't remember missing this.
My mother always talks about polio.
Mm-hmm. So that came.
Do you remember kids in your classes, friends or family that got polio? Because she said, maybe it's because she lived in town, but she said that each school year there'd be one kid who didn't come back because they were at home with polio. Mm-hmm. So that wasn't a big thing in your life?
No.
That was after the war.
Was it later? More yeah. Time? Okay. Well, how about dating? Tell us about dating. Carol, you were
I was 17 when I had my first kiss.
So how did you go about? Did he have to ask permission? Did the boy have to come to your farm and ask permission, or did you set that up yourself, or how was it?
You mean instead of sitting out in the car and honking the horn?
Maybe that's the way it went.
Okay, how did your folks meet your husband, or what, how did that relationship become a relationship that your parents would approve of, or whatever?
Well, my dad liked to drink beer and he liked to play cards. So, and I married a guy that kind of liked to drink beer once in a while, and then he played cards with my dad, so he thought he was great.
And that was what age that you started dating your husband? You said your first child at 17.
First kiss.
Yes.
Big difference.
Yes. 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 That's why I'm getting close.
Yeah. He had buck teeth besides.
What about you, Maxine? Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm married at 21, so
okay.
I kind of made fast tracks.
Oh, my first date? Gosh, I don't remember. Probably was some country kid. I was in high school, I know. But one of the games that we used to play when you all got together in the wintertime when we were kids was post office.
Yeah.
And sometimes you would get a kiss in the post office, but I don't remember.
How did you meet your husband?
How did I meet Bill?
Yep.
I met Bill after the war. He got out of service. Mm-hmm. And, it was a blind date. No, when the binding.
I'm sure you're talking about the right guy.
I was not talking about. We went bowling. He was working in Chicago, and one of the girls in Chicago at the same place was. They were going bowling, and she asked me to go along. Huh. And that's where I met Phil. And he won't admit it, but I beat him in bowling. And that's no man.
Was he older than you? The same age?
No, he was a year. He was a year older.
Year older.
Yeah. He always said I got him when he was weak and run down.
When you were talking, boss? Oh, I'm sorry.
Or, go ahead.
You two ladies are rural, growing up on a farm, and Chuck related to that, as I am and as my wife is also rural.
Yeah.
We are very, very fortunate people to grow up rural.
Oh, yeah.
Because of the education that we got living rural. My two brothers and I were born in a corner bedroom of our farm, delivered by an osteopath.
Oh.
And here we are.
Yeah.
My older brother's deceased. But there was always a separation of country kids and town kids. Is that true?
Right,
mm-hmm.
To some extent. Yeah,
Patsy had the same thing. Yeah. We were not able to go out for sports because there were no school buses in high school.
Mm-hmm.
We drove the family car.
Mm-hmm.
I was hauling my brother and a neighbor girl and myself driving the car when I was 15.
Mm-hmm.
No driver's license, no nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you drive early, either one of you?
I drove. Why?
You drove the tractor,
I drove the tractor. I wasn't too good, sharp about going around the corner. I'd take out a road. But I'd work one day, and then I would sleep, I think, the next day.
Did you have spending money when you were, say, 10 years old?
Good heavens.
Did you have any money in your hand?
Penny on Sunday.
Penny on Sunday. Maybe when you went to town on Saturday, you had a nickel or something.
Yeah, or a dime.
For an ice cream cone.
And that was just about it.
The reason for penny loafer, so that that penny had a place beside the napkin or a handkerchief. Huh?
Yeah.
My mother talks about the distinction between the farm kids and the town kids. She was a town kid. And in high school, she was being pursued by a farm boy.
No.
She would have nothing to do with him because she said, I didn't want to end up on a farm. And he grew up to become a surgeon, but then he died.
Oh,
the road not taken.
So did both sides look down on each other?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, big time.
But I don't think. You paid any attention to it because you didn't socialize them. I know I didn't have a little frilly dress,
mm-hmm.
And they were always, town kids were always having birthday parties.
I have a girlfriend who grew up on a farm in Wisconsin, and she wasn't the Depression, it was probably the 50s. And she says they made dresses out of flower sacks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That just blew me away. Mm-hmm. So well, they see people with
nice material.
Yeah, I still got some pieces of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you? Really? Good for you.
Where Carol and I live, every once in a while, conversation will get on the Depression. And yes, there was a lady said she had dresses out of pizza sacks.
But they had print. They were printed with flowers.
Yeah. With all kinds of different things.
Yeah,
I've got a few pieces.
Probably a selling point.
Linda, you had.
And a couple of different things that my mother shared with us, and she told us that one sad thing was before she was born, she had older brothers, and their dad passed away, and her mother was alone, and because her mother had no source of income. They took her children away, and put them in orphanages and adopted them out. Only one brother wasn't adoptable. He had a cleft palate or something, and so nobody wanted him. And so years later, when my mom's mother remarried, her husband promised her he'd help find the kids. And he did find all of the kids. Two of them were in really nice homes, and then the one that had the cleft palate went into the military and had it fixed. And so she got to know her half-brothers. But then one funny thing she shared with me, she said when I was a little tiny girl going to school, she said she was just a little bit of a thing, as little as Kay and Maxine, if not littler. And she said when there were big snowbanks, you know, and you were talking about walking to school, she said, on the way to school, she said, I was so little that she said, I couldn't walk in the snowbanks because I would disappear. She said, the boys would let me hang onto the back of their coats. And she said, I'd pick up my feet and slide on my butt all the way to school. So she could get the
story.
I always thought that was a funny story.
Great story. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Carol, did you ever go to Minneapolis?
Yes. I went to business school in Minneapolis, and then I got a job.
But I mean as a child, until you were 18?
Well, once or twice. We had relatives that lived there, but it was like a big deal if you went to Minneapolis. Yeah.
Was there a road that was passable? Or did you have to use
yes.
a train?
Yes. They were just, you know, single lane, I think. Or, you know, they weren't freeways or anything. But, yeah, we would get there once in a while.
Was the expectation, was your family's expectation that you would go to work?
Well, I think all young girls went to work. My sisters all went to work, you know, my older sisters, and they did domestic work because going to the country school for 8 grades, that was all you were required to do. And hardly anybody, when I went to school, went any further than that. But I really wanted to go to high school, and I did.
Seems to me graduation rates in the late 40s was around 50% high school graduation rates.
Because, you know, farm boys, they just stayed home and had to help, and then the girls, you know, would go out and work someplace for somebody. It's a hired girl.
Like my aunt, when she went to high school, she roomed with somebody in town and kind of worked for them while she went to high school. Mm-hmm. Then she went to 1 year of normal school and then went backwards. My mother, she, when the country school, she had her own horse. She was an only child. But her dad also built a little cabin on one stone boat or whatever. So she would drive a whole bunch of kids back and forth to school out there in the Norfolk, Fort Berthold Reservation. And I think that's kind of how she went to high school, which was partly in Parshall. And then her folks were losing the farm, so she spent some time in Minot. And then she went to Minot and 1 year, then 2 years. That was of normal school, and then went back and got her bachelor's degree in 1934.
Did either of you ladies, being your own farms, did you have people that you hired to come out and work on the farm from the cities?
Well, we didn't, because I had all those brothers.
Yeah. I remember my dad during the Depression, there was an agency in Minneapolis that he would contact, and there'd be men there available. And they would work for Dad for $15 a month, but they got room and board, you see, in those years, and they were glad to get it. And some of them were Scandinavians. Olli Tangen was one of them. He'd go up to Woodpile and whittle little windmills with his knife. He walked to town sometimes and buy a box of snus.
Oh, yeah.
And come home. They were wonderful people. They were Finlanders and Scandinavians and all kinds of people looking for some place to.
So did they live in your house?
Yes. Oh yeah. My mother washed their clothes.
One or two at a time?
No, just one at a time.
Just one at a time.
About $15 a month.
You know, in terms of inflation, my first year of college teaching, I made $3,000, out of which I paid for all my expenses and saved
$1,000.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. So, you know, when we talk these prices, it's really important to recognize what inflation has done to their meaning.
My school teacher, my dad was clerk of the school board in the one-room country school, which I went to for 8 years. And so Dad would write the check, and then I'd take it down to the neighbor who was the treasurer, and he would sign it, and then I'd take it to the teacher. And she was paid $75 a month. She got a raise. She was $65 a month, and the next year she got $75 a month. And she paid for her room and board at a local farm place. And, of course, she did all the duties, taught all 8 grades. Is that the kind of schooling you went to?
My sister was a teacher too in country school. She got $60 a month.
Yeah. How many in the school?
Well, she had all 8 grades. Some of the 8th grade boys were as big as she was.
Or bigger.
But 30 children, 40 children?
No, not that many. Maybe.
So you went to a one-room schoolhouse?
Oh, we had a two-room schoolhouse.
No, it must have been management.
Well, we never had more than 20 students.
Yeah,
and I was alone most of the time.
Most of my eighth grade, I was the only one in my class. So I told my kids that I was the smartest and the dumbest.
I like it.
They couldn't figure it out.
I've heard so many stories about, not only from you guys, but from others who were on farms, of men coming and wanting to work and food. And I wonder where their families are. In other words, did they abandon their families in order to strike out on their own?
Some came over. Some were from Europe, Scandinavia.
Interesting.
They came and there was no work.
Yeah.
They were in trouble.
Yeah.
A lot were Mexicans, too.
Most of them were trying to get back home.
Okay.
Or maybe they heard of a job someplace.
Hmm.
And it was just my mother and I in the farmhouse. And I often wondered if she was ever leery about anyone coming. If she was, I didn't know about it. But
now you say just your mother and you. Where was your dad?
My dad was in the field working.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
People would come.
So during the daytime, anyway,
yeah,
you were the only ones.
Early evening.
Sure.
If they ever came in the day, of course, they liked to be out on the highway or hitchhiking early in the morning before it was too hot. If we got anybody around noontime, they would sometimes ask if they could rest underneath the shade tree. And they would sit there and, sometime have a nap and then get up and be on their way.
When you guys that are farmers, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Did you have violence or theft or people hurting each other or killing each other in your neighborhood?
Mm-hmm. Never.
We didn't either.
No.
It never happened.
We didn't, but the neighbor down the road had a still in his pig pen.
still.
That's peaceful.
And sometimes people would come from Minneapolis out and buy a little bottle of moonshine, And sometimes they would stop at our farm because it was kind of on the way and ask my dad if we could get him a couple of quarts or whatever it is.
Well, that was prohibition, so your dad was still drinking beer?
Well, no, this was later.
This was later.
I
mean, did everybody
buy
that?
That was the time I was born. Anyhow, that guy ended up going to Leavenworth.
Oh, they were certainly.
That had the
still? Yeah.
Yeah.
Carol, in the, I know in the 20s that the Ku Klux Klan was quite active in Minnesota, and I was just wondering, for either of you, like maybe in Illinois, did you have any experience of Ku Klux Klan in the Carver area or in Illinois when you were children?
There was. In fact, I can remember my dad saying, you know, he thought that this person belonged to the Klan, but there was never any violence or anything like that.
Didn't
he just
have a,
knew about it.
Yeah. I understand that, like in my mother's town, there were no Jews or blacks, and so they focused on the Catholics that they discriminated against and threatened and stuff in Northfield. This is where my mother
We didn't have Jewish people or black people that I knew of.
Well, I have no idea. All you farmers that know, what does a thrashing machine do?
Separate the calf from the grain.
Yeah. Okay, well, when my dad was going through really hard times, he said that they had thrashing crews, and he'd get hired on a thrashing crew to go work to earn money. And I just never knew what that meant. Okay.
That's how they harvested. I mean, it was, instead of a combine, there would be a crew of people that would go around, and often it would be a group of neighbors, you know, my father rode the rails in the 30s because he couldn't find work in the late 30s, and he would find threshing crews in the Dakotas and stuff that he would be able to.
So then they'd be gone for a long time, and then they'd come back home with
their cash. Yeah, in fact, he rode in boxcars, and then there would be camps of people, men that would gather, and in fact their experience was they would be my father and the people that he would meet would go to homes, you know, and ask for food, and they would create a stew of food that everybody gathered, and they would be able to tell if, you know, what a home was good for, because they would mark on the fences, you know, outside of the houses, a little mark, you know, that said, hey, they're good for a potato. These people are good for nothing, you know. I mean, they will not give you anything, that kind of thing. And so you know, they had a way of putting together a food that they would then cook out in their camp outside of town.
Hobo stew.
Yeah, exactly.
There is another major thing in the rural area, and that is the thrashing. In Le Sueur was a man named Walt Biddle, owned a steam engine, a large case steam engine, and a big thrashing machine. He would line up 8 or 10 farmers that were adjacent to each other who had cut all the grain and made grain shocks, and then he would come out from Le Sueur with the steam engine and go to the first farm, and then each of the other farms would come with their wagons and their teams, clear the fields off, and thrash that man's grain, and then they'd move to the next farm, around the circle till they had thrashed all of the wheat, oats, and barley, were the grains that were thrashed at that time. And it was a big event. They even pulled a bunkhouse behind the threshing machine, and a couple rummy dummies from Le Sueur would come along, and they would haul water and saw wood for the threshing machine.
And then there was the cook car.
Having everybody coming in the house.
Do you two ever remember using or hearing about using lard for your bread to take to school?
Well, I
put lard on it.
We had lard, of course, that was used, but we always had plenty of butter, but I know people did use it in their bread.
Because my mother always used to talk about lard. Well, there were 17 kids in the family during the Depression, so they must have had to sell all the cream, so they had to use the lard.
Yeah. Mrs. But Job didn't have that many. somebody mentioned something that I didn't recognize, sorghum.
Sorghum molasses?
Molasses.
Is that molasses?
Yes, molasses.
Sorghum, okay.
There was a mill in Waconia, a sorghum mill, that was still standing when we moved there.
You raise sugar cane, and then you squeeze that sugar cane, the juice comes out, and you cook that juice. Beater Brothers in Belle Plaine, where we used to go to buy molasses, and those became our lunch pails, the half-gallon molasses pails was a lunch pail that we took our lunch to countries from. I still have one.
So, Carol, you said you grew up with no indoor plumbing?
So did I.
So.
So did Vicky.
Well, you know, you should get into schools because they just absolutely don't believe us, the kids. But do you ever remember your first experience with indoor plumbing? Was that quite a miracle?
When I went to high school in Carver, it was the first time I ever sat on a flush toilet.
That must have been something special.
Scare the bejeebers out of little kindergarten.
When did your family get like the water in the house?
Well, they never did. They sold the farm when I was after I was gone, mm-hmm. and then the next owner, of course, put in electricity and water.
Where is your farm? Where was it?
Well,
still there?
You know where the little
churches.
So you
had no electricity. You had no electricity.
No,
we didn't either.
You know where the little East Union Church is out there? Uh-huh. Well, we were right across the field from there.
To the south, or to the north, to the west?
East.
Is it still standing?
The house?
Yes.
It is.
Right. And the people have done, now they got a double garage hanging on it.
Behind the church? Behind the church or in front? I don't know East and West.
Well, if you're standing in the church yard,
then
you
look
across.
Oh, okay.
So were you kind of bordering the St. Ansgar Church property or
well,
the Academy
property?
Well,
about a mile from there.
About a mile, okay.
East.
Yeah. I'm curious about the church and the role that the church played. Whether it was, how much was it a gathering place? Did you go and worship on Sunday morning? And have Sunday school, and that was it, and then that it was basically vacant the rest of the week.
Well,
did you have Wednesday night?
No.
Prayer study?
In fact, we were married out there, but we were married in November, so they weren't about to keep the church for four people, you know, because we just had a really small wedding. So we were married in the parsonage by the church.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You wore a suit.
In English?
In East Union.
Did they speak English?
Yes, but they had Swedish for quite a while, every other Sunday.
And I sat through German every other Sunday.
My older siblings, you know, probably learned the Swedish language, you know. But
so the whole idea of a church as a programmatic institution, that was not even on the radar at that point. Was it?
I remember my mother went. There was Ladies' Aid. Yeah.
But that was held in the parish hall. Was yours held in the church?
Yes.
Well,
ours was. To go to Ladies' Aid with my mother. And then there was church suppers.
Yeah.
Not very many. Not very
much
of that.
Suffer?
No.
Was everybody Scandinavian? Scandinavian German when you grew up?
Pardon?
Were most of the people Scandinavian and
oh,
German?
Oh, heavens, everybody was.
Everybody was.
In school and church. I think we had one little Catholic boy in our grade school.
He's poor little fellow.
Well, during the Depression, I would imagine there wasn't any money to consolidate to have a church or all unpaid ministers.
Yeah,
and
probably so.
One little Catholic, two little Catholics.
I remember when the preacher would come to the hall. And I don't think he believed. I thought smiling was a sin. And if you went to church with your parents, boy, you sat there, you didn't move. Nobody really smiled. I didn't think about it at the time. But one funny thing, my parents liked to dance, and we played cards. But when we'd see the minister come, he was always all dressed up. White shirt, tie, and a dull black suit. We'd always hide the cards. We always hid them in the sewing machine drawer. Because we were real sinners if he caught
us. Oh my God. Go to a movie or a dance.
Now,
doomed.
You were Lutheran, and you were.
Well, my parents were Swedish German,
okay.
But the town that we lived in, And we went to the other town, the church, the Swedish Lutheran church, for a while. But then later on, we just went to the Methodist church, you know. But one thing, was anyone familiar with the orphan train?
You've heard of it.
Anybody
use
the orphan train?
I got the book.
Oh, you do? Uh-huh. One of those wonderful stories. And that was started...
Tell us what it is.
The orphan train was started, correct me if I'm wrong, by a man in New York. Okay, there were so many children living on the street. The families had given them. But then there were families in the West who... you know, wanted to adopt the children or take the children. So the parents would leave them at the train station, and they'd ride the train out someplace west, and people would be there to pick up the child they wanted. Some children had wonderful experiences, you know, and were adopted. The boys, if they were a big boy, the farmers used took them, and some of them were very nice. And in fact, when we were living in Arkansas, at our church, there were two people. One lady rode the orphan train with, there were several children, brothers and sisters. And some of them had wonderful experiences. She did not. And a brother in heaven. But the great thing, they stayed together, and they were all going to get together that summer. So that was, you know, happy ending after that. But that's where the orphan train started.
Wow. I have an old book that's entitled "The Good Old Days Weren't So Good After All." Could you comment about some things that were not so good in those days? So far, I hear a lot of rosy stories about life.
Well,
it was a lot of hard work.
Yeah. You know. And, but one thing, you know, most everybody was in the same situation that you were in. So... and because we always had food and a home, we were well off compared to other people.
So it hit the city people much harder.
We did not have, well, some farmers had it really. For some reason. You know, if you had a serious illness in your family or something like that, but, you know, we managed. We managed by just getting along with what we had.
Well, what would happen if the father died? Do you know any instances of a family where the father died?
Not,
Fred
not when I was growing up.
It would be like what I said with my mother's mother when her father died, not her father, but her brother's father died, and because mother couldn't provide anything. Mm-hmm. For the kids, because she didn't have a job or anything, they just took the kids away and put them in an orphanage and adopted them all. She didn't have a choice in it.
And sometimes the mother would die too in childbirth or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard? Have you all seen the Cinderella Man movie? Mm-hmm. It's worth your while. It's just right in this era. So it really captures all of that. Yeah. The Depression era was really well acted.
Sounds like there were two scenarios, where it was raining and where it wasn't raining. Where it wasn't raining was a double whammy, the Depression plus the Dust Bowl. So it sounds like it wasn't raining here and it was raining in Illinois.
Some places. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there was no Dust Bowl in Illinois, but there was in southern Minnesota. Right, Carol? You said it didn't rain for 2 years here.
Well, no, I don't think it was ever that long, but I know it was really dry.
But as soon as you get west into the Great Plains, which is basically 100 miles west of here, then it's dust.
Dust.
From Canada to Texas. You know. Yeah. So that was a double whammy to the economy.
my father's family sort of was from Salina, Kansas, so that Dust Bowl era. So they were, my grandfather was a horse trader and a auctioneer, so that's, and a realtor later in his life. Completely different feeling. It was a hustling kind of, however you can maneuver. I mean, he was a powerful man, and he wielded his power in his community.
You said what I think is a magic word. That we were all in the same boat. Mm-hmm. And I remember getting really pissed off, pardon the expression, at a woman probably in the 60s or the 70s who was also a faculty member who said, I don't understand why these poor people can't pull themselves up by their bootstraps. We did when we were in the Depression. Mm-hmm. Well, heck, in the Depression, everybody was in the same boat. And you've given so many stories here of how there was cooperation and working together. That's all. She pissed me off, and it still pisses me off.
Well, if someone needed help, and they knew it, all the people would come together.
Went.
I'm also curious, because the mindset that you had was, we just need enough. Mm-hmm. It's okay if we have, as long as we have enough. Mm-hmm. When did the consumer culture and the need to, the desire to envisioning life as amassing stuff, when did that?
After the war.
Right after the war.
The war.
But it was also after World War
right
I.
After
too.
The war?
No, as the prices went up, when hogs went from 30 cents to 48 cents a pound, money flowed in.
Yeah.
And then the change came. That's what happened.
Yeah.
The war. War yeah. economy.
Yeah.
Right?
Women
everything
went to work during the war.
Man, we're there.
Yeah. Were you
then came violence.
Working during the war?
Pardon me?
Were you working? I don't care. Your husband went overseas. And
yes.
You went over with him, too, I remember.
Not overseas, but I was with him in the States when I could be.
But was your husband in the
Bill was in service, yeah.
What did you do when they were gone?
Well, I didn't know Bill when he was in service. We met after he
had
out of service.
Well, I worked.
But you worked.
But I, I had a child.
So tell them what you did.
Oh, well, I worked at Teletype Corporation in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And I worked there. Well, I had other couple other jobs before that, but then I went to Teletype Corporation, and I worked there for 5 years mm-hmm. before I was.
What did you do?
Married. I was they called them a stenographer there, but then I worked in personnel. Mm-hmm. I liked personnel work, and I worked there.
Carol, you worked.
I worked at Sears Roebuck, the big store on Lake Street.
Oh, really?
Really? I remember
that
was
the
first job.
Well, how did you get sent?
Well, we lived in Minneapolis at that time.
Oh, you did?
But when we
street
got married, car.
Where in Minneapolis did you live?
We lived in Firehorn Park. It was our first apartment.
Huh. Well, I remember
my husband lived at the Ford plant.
Yeah. Powderhorn Park is where you lived by?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And I worked at Sears.
Yeah.
So it was
Powderhorn.
Do you remember the actual address or the
Chicago,
street? What street it was?
Sears.
No, your home, your apartment.
I think it was 1220 Powderhorn Terrace or something.
Okay.
Which was a nice district at that time.
Sure. Yeah. There's some beautiful apartment buildings.
And we paid $45 a month for our apartment that was furnished.
Yeah.
And
one bedroom, two bedroom?
One bedroom.
One bedroom, yeah.
Furnished and heated.
Yeah. But that was kind of glorious.
And I walked to work, and my husband worked in St. Paul at the Ford plant, and he drove our 35 Ford.
Yeah.
Thank
what were you
ladies.
What did you do
at Susan? I got
one,
to leave.
One more.
Well,
we have to
wrap
it up.
Huh? In the mail order.
Max, oh, yeah. They had a huge mail order
thing. So that's what I did.
That's what most of that building was.
I think maybe we need to wrap it up.
Back in the Ward store.
Those of you who have further questions.
I love it.
29 cents an hour.
This has been so great fun. Thank you.